It's a G.I. Jive, man alive. It starts with a bugler blowing reveille over your bed when you arrive. Hey, Jack, that's a G.I. Jive.
Hello, Wasteland. It's your old pal, Tiki the Hutt. Now, I know, this channel mostly covers tabletop wargaming, and I'm playing a lot of Conflict 47 and a few other things, and I've been gone for quite a bit. Well, I'm back, and also, spoiler alert, I'm a pretty big Fallout fan. Have been for the longest time, so I wanted to start something called Fallout Friday. This is where I'm going to start doing a podcast, maybe once a month, maybe twice a month. Who knows? It's the wasteland. Nothing for certain. But what is for certain is I'm joined on my first episode by a good buddy of mine. Even in real life, I have friends. I know it's weird. His name is Kreech. Kreech, how you doing, good buddy?
Oh man, I'm doing just fine. How are you?
I am living the dream, actually. So with that being said. Fallout. How did you ever hear about this? What got you into it, and what was your first game? Where did you get that Fallout moment?
Well, Fallout 3 was the first game, but as you said, the Fallout moment for me happened with New Vegas, and it was pretty quick into New Vegas. It was one of those games that, I mean, I'm playing it again now, you know, what, 10, 15 years later? It's been out, we're getting old, so, but it's one of those games that I can play over and over again, and it never gets old for me.
I got you. No, same. Ironically, the first game that, I guess the first video game that really hit me pretty hard, and I realized there's more to it, I'll never forget, my brother, who I know, we won't mention his name, but he always had great taste in games, right? So he went out and got a game called Arcana. At first I made fun of him, was like, what is that, a dwarf with a flamethrower? How nerdy is that? And then I played it, I was like, this game is awesome! And then I kind of like backtracked a little bit, you know, from Troika games, and that's how I discovered. You know, I saw other Fallout games come out. I remember sitting and reading an Xbox magazine when they were talking about, you know, the one that which people don't mention, you know, Fallout Brotherhood of Steel, the Diablo clone takes place in Texas. Well, it wasn't that one. But I kind of went back a little bit, you know, went to my local big box store, and I found the only Fallout game I found was Tactics. And it was amazing.
Man.
Fallout Tactics was my first one.
Non-canon. Non-canon, might I add.
I know it's not canon. I know. There's parts of it that could be. Using vehicles is kind of weird, but it was fun. It was a really actual fun, crunchy tactical game, and I enjoyed it. I graduated, went to college. In between college and my enlistment, I got deferred for a year because I wanted to join a career field, and I had to wait a year. I was like, okay. So I went to go work construction, you know, away from my hometown and like live on site and work there in a hotel room. So it was like the greatest thing ever. So I took an Xbox with me, and I was like, well, I need a game to play. And someone told me about, it's like, oh, you like Oblivion, you know, not, it wasn't Oblivion, I'm sorry. You like Elder Scrolls, like Morrowind, you'll like this Fallout game, Fallout 3. So I played it, and like many other people, I do not remember that year. I felt like I lost an entire year where I just saved money, you know, and just played Fallout 3, which was awesome. And then I went in the military myself, you know, went through basic, you know, tech school, stuff like that. Didn't play a lot of video games. I had a cool job, so I didn't really have to. And it wasn't until my second base when I got married, I got put on a separate shift than my wife. And I was like, well, I need something to kind of keep me awake. I was like, oh, she has an Xbox. That's cool. Let me go find a game. And then I saw New Vegas. It's like, is this like a DLC? I mean, Fallout 3 was great, but... And then I put in New Vegas, and that became my life for a little while. Work and playing New Vegas. It helped me maintain my sleep schedule. And I played so much New Vegas that it was not even healthy.
I think what's the craziest part of that is somebody who's freshly married, the fact that you said... Gatorade is something so foreign to me right now. But we don't work opposite shifts, so that's probably why. But
no, that's true. I love my wife to death. She wanted to spend time together when we first got married.
Yeah,
I totally get that. But I also worked a night shift, so it's like, okay, my days off are done. How do I get back on a night schedule? It's like, what can I do for 12 hours? And hello, Mojave Wasteland. Like, that definitely checked that box.
I don't blame you, brother. That's exactly what I'd be doing. I agree with you there. Vegas was just so... It was so different. It's so funny you mentioned Morrowind too, because much like Morrowind, Fallout 3 is not aged well, and a lot like me too. But it's a great game still. Even when you look at it, it's hard to look at it now, especially with how everything's changed in the game world, because it's not pretty. But I think that it made up for that with just a fantastic story, characters that are memorable, and so many great moments that happen, and it never gets old. It'll never get old.
Yeah, and I think a lot of people ask, like, why do you like Fallout? So without getting too much into what I did in the military, I had an appreciation for, like, Fallout and the topic of Fallout, you know, due to this and the stuff I've seen. And I think what I really enjoyed the most, I think what gets me, and it's not just Fallout, I like it in other things too. If you've seen some of my videos, you'll know how I kind of, like, mix humor in with other kind of stuff, is, you know, dark humor, a coping mechanism. And I know it wasn't traditional to the... Okay, so the first two Fallouts did have humor. I have gone back. I have played all the Fallouts, even 76. But I have played all of them. And the humor is always there, don't get me wrong. But it was the juxtaposition of the music and the violence in Fallout 3 that was just chef's kiss. Like, you walk out, it's a terrible apocalypse. DC is completely, like, blown off the scale, off the world. There's, like, craters everywhere.
Oh, yeah.
You're still listening to, like, you know, Civilization, which is hilariously ironic because it's bombed out of Civilization, you know, while you're chasing down somebody, like, drinking Nuka Cola, like a Coca Cola to gain health while slinging 10 mil rounds. Like, it's just the grand irony. I don't think anyone hits irony the way Fallout does. It's just like this sweet, almost like an umami kind of flavoring of
I like that.
Irony.
I like that, a little tangy. No, I'm there with you, man. I think and I'm going to keep going to New Vegas on this one, but there was that moment where Johnny Guitar came on, and I'm in the middle of the desert walking around, you know, these gigantic radioactive scorpions floating around me. And I was like, is this an action game or a horror game? It's just something about the ambience that some of that music creates in that kind of environment that's just, I don't see that being created anywhere else in any other game I've ever played. It does so well of going from that, this is fun, blowing up, shooting stuff, loud bang, to this quiet moment where you have this music going. You're like, am I in a horror game, or is what happened to the fun blowing up stuff that was just happening?
It's funny you say that, because when I played New Vegas, I couldn't tell if it was like a bug I got or what. It was just a super depressing song, and I felt like every time I like left some kind of town, I was walking in the desert, I kept getting Johnny Guitar.
It's such a good,
like,
song.
You know, yeah, like that revolver starts looking real friendly. I was like, geez. I was like,
I'm ye in my halls out here, buddy.
Yeah, I was like, is it like a game feature? I'll just keep getting this depressed. Every time I get closer, I start getting more upbeat song. I was like, I don't know if it's a game feature or a bug, or if that's just their design overall. You know, any bug that's fun is game design. But, you know, overall, no, I absolutely love New Vegas. And what got me, being a huge ammo nerd in real life, is someone on that development team somewhere has definitely been to a range. And what I mean by that is, I'm talking, they know the difference between a 223 and a 5.56 millimeter,
oh,
or
yeah,
shooting 38 special out of a 357 weapon. And then there's different types of 357 or 38 special too. You can have lead, semi watercolor, hollow points, or regular. They all do different stuff. And shotguns, it's one of the only games I've seen that made shotguns as useful as they truly are with the different types of ammo. And I'm not just talking about coin shot, which is hilarious, but you know, like pulse slugs, which would be a great addition. And then you have different types of buckshot, like there's double odd buck and number four. I was like, this is just awesome stuff that I really haven't seen replicated in many games.
Oh yeah, or the tritium sights on the varmint rifle. Let's we've got the night sights coming off this little, you know, plinker lever action. I agree with you. I think that the gun design, ammo design in that game, I haven't seen that replicated really anywhere else. Especially for a game of that time, too. I mean, we've had all these, you know, multi-million dollar production games since. You think that somebody could pay that much attention to having that big of a budget when you look back at New Vegas and how old it is. But they got it right. They did it right the first time.
And the time it took, that's always a shocker. Like, yeah, they had a building block to build off of Fallout 3, of course. But the amount of time they turned that thing around was impressive. And I think what got me, it was in Fallout 3 a little bit, but it was more New Vegas. I think that's what really, like, sunk its hooks into me, or Deathclaw, I guess, to be specific. It was the how choices matter.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my God. Like, I've played games with good dialogue. I've played game where choices matter. Alpha Protocol comes to mind, which is another buggy game. But, you know, it's another game where choices matter, but no one hit it like New Vegas. Like, everything you do really and truly matters. And as someone who plays D&D with me in real life, I know, you know, that's my thing.
Oh, yeah.
It's like, choices matter.
There's consequences. We're not even going to go down that. I'll just start getting angry. It's mentioning our current D&D campaign. And, yeah, it's evil DM. Don't ever
Robo
play
D&D. Mimics, man.
Brother. I've been scared of my furniture in my living room since that.
You You can't even go in the kitchen and make toast without a 9mm in case the toaster starts moving.
No, yeah, brother, I stay with the toilet gun. That's it ain't gonna catch me with my pants down.
But yeah, the choices matter and the consequences of your actions. I absolutely love it, but I feel like, and I could be wrong, it could be an old man yells at clouds moment, but I feel like that's something a lot of modern games are kind of getting away from. It's like, oh no, you could do everything, you're all powerful. This is like, sure, you could do that, for better or worse, like, and here's what happens, you know, like, here's the consequences of your actions.
Well, even taking it back to, I think, Fallout 1, even the way you layer your stats, I think wasn't it Fallout 1 where if you put it, you took all of your points, put it in strength, didn't put them in intelligence, your character couldn't form like full sentences. And I thought that was like one of my favorite things, because you some of the characters in that game would just feel bad for you, so they just give you stuff because you were this big blubbering idiot. And I think
yes, yeah, that definitely happened. And if Tim Kane, if you ever listen to this by any weird you know, side thing, yeah, it's a big world out there where he's listening to this. I first ran into that with Arcanum. What I love is when you're making your character, you got to choose their background, and it was never like, hey, you get +5 to this automatically. It's like, no, you get, like, one could be you were a circus freak. It's like, yeah, you get +5 to throwing skill, but you lost an eye due to a horrible accident, and now you've been, you know, and you're the son of a bearded lady, so you get like -2 to appearance and -1 to perception because you only have one eye. I was like, I love that, you know, there's like a rose with thorns, you know, and it's like no one's this perfect character. And the other thing I loved from Fallout 1 was, you know, spoiler alert for Gabe, I don't even know how it's old now.
But, yeah, a little late for that.
Yeah, if you need your vault needs water, right? Spoiler alert. And so if you find the water merchant, you can tell them where the vault is, which is good because your vault needs water. That gives you more days to play the campaign. Mm-hmm. The bad news is there goes your OPSEC. You know, once you tell the water merchants where your vault is, anybody's going to know where your vault is, you know, and sure enough, your vault could get raided that much faster. So I thought that was a cool consequence of your actions. You think you're doing good, but, you know, you're not really thinking about what you're doing. I think it really lends it to that naive vault dweller thing that I absolutely love, and I know we'll bring up later. Well, with all that being said, we've kind of talked, obviously, we both love the hell out of New Vegas, but who doesn't, honestly? You talk to the community, I mean, that's probably one of the top ones. But what was your favorite of all the games? I don't know if 76 counts, but of all the games, what was your favorite Fallout moment?
So 76 wasn't a game. It was just a fever dream, if you ask me, in my world. My favorite moment, and I'm going to sound like a broken record here, the lottery winner when you first encounter Caesar's Legion.
Smell that sweet air!
I cannot tell you how many times I made it a point after several playthroughs to try to hit him with a round in the face before he could get to me. But it's just, he was still one of my favorite characters, and that one of my favorite moments of any of the games. Because here's all these people like literally crucified behind him. And he's just running up excited. I love that movie. I think it set the tone too for the rest of that game after that moment. Is that I think it goes back to our point we were making earlier, that how that game is able to go from this is fun, hello, haha, joke. Oh, also here are some crucified bodies right behind him in the background.
Yeah, like total whiplash. Like, oh, haha. And meanwhile, you probably have something like jingle, jingle, jingle.
Yeah.
On your Pip-Boy playing, like, I got spurs. That yeah. Jingle, jangle, jingle. And it's like playing in time with the crackling fire of the crucified people at the time.
So here's
like,
huh. But also a war crime. It just puts a hand out. This is the Geneva suggestion in this town. And I love that so much. I think that's. I mean, it may not even be one of my favorite Fallout moments, one of my favorite game moments of all time. It really set the tone for what Fallout is, I mean, to its roots.
No, yeah, no, I totally get that. It's so funny, I'm actually taking a trip to Tier soon, and that's one of the main things. Me and my wife, we're not there for very long, we kind of divvied up what we want to do. You know, are there any shows you want to see, stuff like that. So me being the nerd I am, I was like, well, one day we're getting a rental car, and some bobbleheads, some bottle caps, we're going on a road trip. Like, we're gonna go hit all these places. You know, so I'm going to like Good Springs and
oh, cool, man.
Yeah, all those Nipton. Of course, I'm gonna try and see if I can buy a lottery ticket from the gas station there. You never know. You know, maybe head up to Prim.
Hey, you know, totalitarian, you know, Hail Caesar. See what happens.
It's hard. This whole thing, and obviously no one's ever done a podcast. Like, I drafted these questions, obviously. Even I'm having a difficult pick in one moment, and I've thought about this for a while. Oh, man. You know, it's really tough. I actually have a couple, unless that's cheating.
No, go for it.
One of I know, right? I have all the power now. No, one of them was being able to talk down at the end of New Vegas, being able to like fully talk down both sides, not just on on the Legion side, but also be able to talk down Oliver and the New California Republic, and being like, because that's always been my my playthrough style. You know, obviously it's not realistic, but you know, luckily it may not sound like it online. But in person, I've always been kind of verbose, and in my career field involves a lot of talking, a lot of like social engineering and things like that. So yeah. I've always been a huge talkative person, and I enjoy small arms and things like that. So when I make my character, I generally always go, you know, speechcraft, barter, small arms. You know, if you can't dazzle them with bullshit, then riddle them with bullets kind of gameplay.
So you're a bard in all games, not just
right?
Steve.
Yeah. That,
weird.
that literally, yeah, it's basically a wasteland bard. For lack of a better word, it's always kind of been my go-to character, kind of like Captain Jack Sparrow with like a 10 mil.
No, plasma will heat metal too, so I guess it's all
yeah,
it's all
right. Oh, definitely. But yeah, being able to talk them both down and that be an option, I know it's in other Fallout games. I know everyone will. I'm sure I'll see that in the comment section if anyone does comment. No, well, that wasn't Fallout 1 and 2. Yeah, especially Fallout 1, where you're able to convince the master. You know, I played much later. You know, I was able to talk to the master and show him the error in his plan. It's like, oh, well, shit. Well, I guess I'll just die then. And he kills Cobain's right there in the middle of this podium.
Relatable.
So, yeah. That's always been one of my favorite things, is being able to use speechcraft. But as far as, like, just pure gameplay, where I'm like, oh, this is good, I'm not going to lie, it actually comes from Fallout 4, of all things, which I don't, according to the hours played, I must love the game. But I don't hate the game, I don't love the game. It's just a decent Fallout chapter. But I'll never forget my first playthrough, and obviously with my background being military, I kind of always leaned more towards the Brotherhood of Steel, particularly in that Fallout 4. Yeah, I'll never forget flying in a vertibird after playing so many Fallout games. Flying in a vertibird with a minigun and just basically strafing the ground, and instead of like a Vietnam era you know, way Fortunate Son playing, you know, I forget which song it was. I want to say it was Mighty Mighty Man. You know, it's like, I'm a mighty mighty man while I'm sitting there just hosing down a parked Corvega, which blows up, sending raiders flying in pieces. So like, you know what, this is it. Like, this is solid gameplay. Because for Fallout 4, what a lot of people know is my longest deployment, before I left for it, I had to go to a really long pre-deployment training. And before I went on the pre-deployment training, I found out Fallout 4 was going to be released. I'm a huge Fallout fan. I was like, great, I'm going to miss Fallout 4. Awesome. And so, ironically, my pre-deployment trainer, its pre-deployment training center, our field training exercise was way out in the desert between Texas and New Mexico. So we spent a lot of time literally just walking around what would look like the Mojave Desert. I was like, oh, this is hilarious.
Very similar. Yeah, that's why they picked that area.
Exactly. I was like, oh, yeah, very nice. So, you know, playing New Vegas and think about that. And then on my whole deployment during the down times, you know, all I had was my beat up laptop, my Steam account. So I downloaded some of the older Fallout games, because what a lot of people know is you're kind of capped on how much you can download and stuff like that. So I would slowly, incrementally, like, download the older Fallout games to play.
Yeah, somebody so always hoards the hard drive.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, the morale drive. So yeah, I caught up on all the old Fallout games. And I was so excited to come back and play Fallout 4. My wife, being the awesome person she is, I mean, she had the game ready. By then, it had like a game of the year, not a game of the year, but like a full edition that came with like a pair of socks and like the season pass for all the DLC. I was like, oh, this is awesome. And I was
I
like,
judge how old I'm getting by how often my favorite games from my childhood become Game of the Year editions. That's how I've decided I'm getting old.
Yeah, that's how I marked my age. But yeah, as I came back, I was like, is this game going to be worth the wait? And yeah, when that moment happened, I was like, oh, this is totally worth the wait. I was like, this is absolutely phenomenal. But yeah, I think that's probably going to be my big Fallout moment. The ability, when I found out I could really talk my way out of everything, because I was so scared, you know, I was going to build a really cool build, and then get to the very end, it's going to be a boss battle, I was just going to get stomped. But I was like, no, this build was viable. I was able to talk my way out of everything, and I absolutely
go,
love that.
Go the Mr. Handy route. Just take the robot army. Just go full charisma, talk them both down, and then I think that was a cool part about Vegas too, was just the multiple endings. I don't think I, prior to that one, really played a game that I was like, I got to see how these other ones end. I think the replay on that alone was perfect.
It's so funny you say that, because that leads into the next thing I want to ask you. So the show coming out on April the 12th, I want to say, because they moved it. Because I got the day off for when it dropped, and they moved it a day, and I was like, oh, son of a bitch. But it's okay. I'm gonna have to watch it the day after. But it's fine. Movie wife, we already have like a watch party going on. We're getting like, you know, themed food and drinks. I made hard root beer, you know, Sunset Sarsaparilla. So we have like our whole nerdiness going. So we're gonna enjoy the hell out of it when it comes out.
Yeah, I actually installed depleted uranium in my AC unit for the. Now I'm excited too. My wife and I, we're definitely gonna be watching it.
So based off that show coming out, based off all the teasers, trailers, and clips, I think there's been a couple floating around that they were recording this. So taking what you know about New Vegas and Fallout 1 and 2, how do you feel about this show? Are there things you're excited about? Are there things you're worried about? What did you notice that kind of popped out to you?
Well, I think for me right now, dude, it's looking... I've been hurt before, man, with so many shows and recreations of video games and books that I try to go into these, especially when they take like subject matter that I love. And granted, yeah, I mean, you've seen, I've got Fallout tattoos on my left arm. I've got the Mysterious Stranger, Nuka Cola, and of course, Brotherhood of Steel. So pretty big fan. So I'm going into it very, you know, tentative, hoping. But from what I've seen practical effects wise, it looks good, man. It looks really good. And I'm really excited to see what they do with it and hope that they stay, you know, not 100% true to the subject matter, but not, you know, take too many liberties with it. Because it, for what it is and lore-wise and what already exists in this universe, there's so many great things that they can do and explore. They shouldn't have to travel that far outside of the subject matter. You know what I mean? And, you know, because I look at, like, shows like, you know, the Halo series, where episode one, we're seeing Master Chief without his helmet on, and I'm like... what are you doing? Like, you've taken the one sacred thing and ruined it already. And so I'm going into a tentative, but man, the trailer looks so freaking good. The practical effects, the makeup, the guns, the Brotherhood of Steel armor. I've got really good high hopes for this. I'm really looking forward to it.
Yeah, and I've been excited. Each clip I watch, same thing. I've been hurt before in the past. I've seen a couple things kind of pop off. But some things went off well. Like a good example, and I'm not shilling. Everyone who knows this channel is never monetized, never will be monetized. So my opinions are my own. I kind of just throw them out as I see fit. But Twisted Metal, I'm a huge fan of that too. That show wasn't bad. Wasn't the best.
Really?
But it wasn't bad. Like, I enjoyed it. There were enough cars. Like, when you really look into it, most of the characters are there. You kind of have to look for it and, like, squint your eyes a little bit. But it wasn't bad. It could have been a lot worse. I know it sounds so bad to say, but... in the realm, I'm not going to just go down the list of like angry guy named shows that aren't the way he wanted, but there's just plenty to pick from. I don't even have to name them. But Halo was definitely one of them to call.
Yeah. Yeah. But, I mean, Grant, let me backtrack a little on that. Halo alone by itself, when you're not being like a super nerd like me, it is great. It's fantastic. And I think a lot of people will say that if you can remove yourself from the purest nerd guy that, you know, that I am right now, it's fine. It's not bad.
I refuse. But no, you're not wrong. A funny one is, and even if something is not based on it, but there's enough of it, people will lose their mind. A great example, I think it's called like Blood Moon, that newest Zack Snyder one, which is just like really heavy Warhammer 4. I watched this, like, this is just Warhammer 40K with extra steps. Like, it's not, it's basically like a Kurosawa film. I get where they're going with, because so was the original Star Wars. It was based off old Samurai Saw films. But what's funny is the story and the lore for that is the exact same as A Bug's Life. I was like, this is just Bug's Life with Warhammer 40K imagery. It's not bad. It's not good, but
Bug's Life 40K.
But the way I'm looking at it is just, it's so funny. Maybe it's because nerds were bullied in high school. I don't know. I'm not a weird guy. Like, I don't know like the whole mind thing to it. But with the internet, it's so easy to just like beat something down. And the reason why I mentioned that is the people who put on the show, I know he made that comment, everyone's freaking out. It's like, this isn't for the fans, or like, grab all the pitchforks and torches. But I see what he's saying. It's like, you can't make it for the fans. And I get it, because even as fans, we can't agree on what the best Fallout game is. I think it's New Vegas. A lot of people do think it's New Vegas, but
yeah,
people will
everybody
fight.
Everybody who doesn't say that is wrong.
Yeah, everybody, everybody will fight, you know, on what the best faction is, or what the best Fallout game is. I mean, they won't agree on anything. So you want to put them in a committee to make a show, it'll be absolute garbage. So one person's like, I'm just going to make what I think would be cool. I'm a Fallout fan. I think he said he lost a year of his life too, playing Fallout 3. You know, he's like, well, I'm just going to make the Fallout that I want, and I'm going to try and make it cool. So let's just have fun. Like, I get that mentality, and I'm Same thing, I've had my heart broken too with shows before, so I'm kind of skeptical, but overall, I'm at least happy that it's building a resurgence in Fallout, which means more mods will come back out for Fallout 4. I think they're releasing a graphics update for Fallout 4 on Xbox, which is cool. All the Fallout merch is coming out. I have like a man cave full of Fallout merch, so that's super useful for me. You know, literally just the other day, I went and purchased a 10mm firearm, like a real world one. And while I was at the store, they literally asked me, like, oh, dude, I'm glad you came in. Like, is this real or is this like for the memes? I was like, little column A, little column B. Yeah, I was like, yeah, I'm going to try and make it look like a weathered 10mm pistol. He's like, brother, you need to look at this. And he spins his phone around. And sure enough, this dude has built a service rifle. So he took like an AR-15, put all wood furniture, like carved on the symbols and everything. I was like, how hard was it to find wood furniture? He's like, dude, it was almost as expensive as the gun. It's like, and it was so hard to get fitted, but it looks so clean.
Fellow man of culture, I see.
We'd right?
See that. Well, and I think this goes along with the old trope of, you know, any publicity is good publicity. And I think that the Fallout, you know, the cult we are needs something after 76. We need something to bring us back and give us a little hope for the future. I think we were all, and I won't say all because I don't want to generalize here, but a lot of us were hurt by 76, and we just need something to bring us together again. You know what I mean?
Yeah. 76 broke my heart like the back of a prom on, or back of a limo on prom night. Yeah. I took the day off and everything. I was like, oh man, it's going to be awesome. And I was like,
I did too.
Shit. I played for a full day, but I didn't really enjoy it.
And then it burned when I peed the next day. And I was like, oh man.
Yeah, that sounds like 76. So the whole thing with 76, people who do play it, I get why certain people enjoy it. I get the type of game that they made and the type of game people who, to me, there's nothing wrong with Borderlands. I like Borderlands. You know, there's nothing wrong with another good example. You look at Far Cry 5. I think they did one after Far Cry 5, which is after the nukes hit. And the games are different. And it's the same thing they did with Tom Clancy's Division 2. It's a really cool idea.
Really great
idea. But when you do the online gameplay and you do with like, hey, I have a Colt 1911. Well, I have a Colt 1911, but my writing is in blue, so therefore it does more damage. Like, that kind of breaks it. And then characters, because they have to keep leveling up, basically just become bullet sponges, right? I have some guy running around like in a puffy jacket in New York with a bread in his hand, and I hit him with a 12 gauge. That should drop him in most places, you know, even with meth, that'll still drop him. But, you know, if this guy's a level 50, you know, thug or whatever, then he has more health. It just kind of ruins it. So that's what got me with Fallout 4. Like, a 10 millimeter is a 10 millimeter is a 10 millimeter. Or like a plasma pistol is a plasma pistol. So when I was like, but I have a level 35 plasma pistol, so mine does more damage. I think that's what got me with 76. It's like, I can't take this.
Yeah, it stops being about like, you know, your ability in the game, and it starts being, you know, unemployed versus employed. Because you got people that can, you know, play for, to grind this stuff out. And maybe it's a skill issue, and I'm going to have people in, you know, if they comment saying, you know, get good.
Get good.
Yeah, I get it. Okay, that's fine, man. But, you know, I can't. So, you know, I wonder if maybe it could have been fixed when you look at games like, you know, Ghost Recon, Breakpoint did a good part where they had two ways you play the game. You had one where it's, you find a better gun that's green text, and so that's better than the gun that you had before. This is a level 15, you know, AK-12. And then they also had a version where all the guns were the same, you know, as far as they were blueprint, you pick up this gun, you could play with this gun for the entire game all the way to the end, because there isn't a leveling system anymore. So there was two versions you could play of the main game. And so, I don't know. I think I'm with you on that 76. It started becoming so grindy, and it started becoming so, well, here I am just trying to enjoy the wasteland, and I've got a level 452 sweaty guy coming in and blowing up all my stuff. And maybe that just kind of took the mystique away for me.
Yeah, and I think the other thing that got me, and it's something with online games, and again, old man yells at clouds, I get it, but I don't like losing out on content where it's like, I can never go back and play the Fallout 76 that dropped the day we played it. I'm not just talking about the bugs, I'm talking about the storyline where there were no humans, it was mostly robots. Now it's just like, okay, we redid the story, I was like, well, do I have access to what used to be? And they're like, no. But I'm not gonna lie, most of my gameplay from Fallout 76 was either setting up my camp, where I set it up as like a barter town kind of thing. Like, I want to set up, once they set up stores, I thought that was kind of cool. And something I did like from Fallout 76, you know, a little thorn with my rose here, it's actually the only battle royale that I ever actually enjoyed. I don't know if you've ever played Nuclear Fire, but
I did.
So the cool thing about it is it's stuck in one vault, and whoever wins gets to be the overseer kind of thing. It's kind of cheesy, but whatever. But the cool thing was, is there was tons of NPC monsters all over the map. So you had to go around and pick up weapons and armor. So you kind of got that Fallout scavenger thing going. You know, you don't really have time to be like, well, this gun's better than that gun. You just grab whatever gun you can find with whatever ammo you can find. And more importantly, there's still ghouls and all sorts of monsters running around. So you'll be sneaking through a town, and then you'll see some ghouls, and you're like, I can't sneak past them. If I shoot them, then everyone's going to know where I am, and someone's going to be waiting. They're going to snipe me in the back of the head. So it actually introduced a really cool type of battle royale, and it disappeared. So, you know, can't really play it anymore. That's kind of sad.
See, I wish you would have prefaced this before you just dropped the dopest, like, trailer for that. I was sitting here in my head like, maybe I should re-download it, then you die from my dreams at the end.
Psych! Gotcha!
You know, it would be really cool if you did it. Too bad if you can't now.
I feel like that old commercial with the guy has, like, the dollar bill on the thing. Oh, you almost got it. Like, it's classic.
Appreciate that, man.
It was fun. It was an awesome battle royale.
It sounds fantastic. Like I said, you almost made me read down 76.
Because all the good stuff, like all the actual like power armor and heavy stuff like that was all in the center of the map where you knew you were going to get blasted if you went there. Also, you can call down nukes too, just like you could in the game. So everyone's like, I'll just hide. It's like, I'll just nuke the map if I find enough, you know, nuclear codes. Like, it was a really cool battle royale. Until it's not. So
here's hoping the show brings.
Yeah, so speaking of your heart already being broken, now that I've kind of ripped in and kind of like ripped it apart, what about the trailers kind of like stood out to you? Like, what did you notice as a fan? What did you notice as, or maybe what did someone else in your house notice who wasn't a fan? You know,
well, okay, so I'll say this. We're gonna drop a little me lore here. A lot of people don't know. So I went to art school, and this is all gonna come together. And so for me, sculpting is one of my favorite things. And so the reason that being is from old movies with practical effects and practical makeup and less CGI, the better. That's one thing that stood out to me in this trailer was I'm looking at actual FX makeup on the ghoul's face. I'm looking at what seems to me a lot of practical sets. And I think we talked to this prior to starting this episode. That's what stood out to me. And it just gives it such an organic look, and the art nerd in me is just eating that up. I love that. And so I'm really excited to see how far they go with those practical effects. You know, are we gonna get, you know, sculpted monsters? Are we gonna get, you know, the less CGI the better kind of, you know, scenario? That's what that really stood out to me. I'm really excited about seeing what they do with that.
You know, that makes sense now, because we were talking before this podcast, like I said, we're actually friends in real life, which is kind of cool if you believe I have friends. But you're talking about how cool the ghoul makeup looks for Walter Goggins, and I was like, yeah, it actually, because some people wanted like the Fallout 3, the new Vegas school, you know, but I kind of like this one. It seems like, especially out in the more like arid places, is, you know, the ghouls have kind of cooked in the sun for a bit, so I think it kind of works.
Yeah. No, I agree with that. Yeah, it's and that's a great point. You know, it does. It looks like, it looks sun-baked ghoul, but you know, you can tell they're using that liquid latex and using actual FX. They're not giving us, you know, some half a green screen face, and that it just adds to the authenticity, I guess, for me in that moment.
I think another thing that's coming is you have some older Fallout fans, you have some of us who played what I'll call, like, I think you have, I don't want to use like gold, silver, because I think people equate that with value. I'd say the early age of Fallout, I'd say it's like Fallout 1, 2, and Tactics. Brotherhood is, no one really counts that one. I think the middle age is where you have 3 in New Vegas. And now I think the newest age, of course, is Fallout Shelter, which ironically a lot of people don't know this, is they were working on that way back in Fallout 3. You can kind of see it in the trailer a little bit. They already had it kind of built, which is cool. But Fallout Shelter, Fallout 4, 76 if you have to, and some of the other stuff out there, but is a lot of stuff changes, and of course that's aesthetics, you know, and access to different stuff, or sometimes, and that's the other thing, Fallout has always been open to retcons. I listened to Tim's channel a lot, and I listened to him talk about Fallout. I find it super interesting, but yeah, they had to retcon some stuff between Fallout 1 and 2, and it kind of makes sense, because I look at it kind of like Mad Max. If you're not a big Mad Max fan, you look at a lot of movies, some stuff doesn't line up, but the whole reason is because it's being passed down. It's like a verbal history amongst the wasteland. So a lot of stuff is going to be changed or dropped, and that's why they can create a male or female character. It doesn't matter. You're just the sole survivor, or you're just the lone wanderer, because stuff like that gets lost in the details, which is kind of cool. But I think a lot of the costumes I think it might throw some people, because some people are like, why are they using that assault rifle? I hate the way the assault rifle in Fallout 4 looks. That thing looks so, it's like a Lewis gun had like unprotected love making with some other like giant. It's, but I think the whole reason they're doing that is they're kind of taking a page from Game Workshop's and Warhammer 40K genre way early on, where if you just make generic stuff, you don't copyright it, people will just yoink that stuff.
Oh, yeah.
So you can't have Space Marines. You have to have, you know, the Adeptus Astartes. You can't have the Imperial Guard. You know, I mean, France had that. You know, you have to have the Ash Bolt Arms. The same thing. You can't just have, like, obviously, what was in Fallout 3? That you had the Chinese, so a Type 56, a Chinese assault rifle, or regular assault rifle, I think it was like a G3. You can't just have generic firearms. You know, you have to make it look unique to the Fallout universe, so that way you can copyright it. You got to protect your IP, which I can appreciate. So I think that's why they're leaning, same thing with me, vault suits. Like, I kind of made my own vault suit, but I don't, just because obviously I'm a bigger guy too, but I don't like the one from Fallout 4, which basically looks almost like a skin tight kind of jumpsuit. I get why they use it with Fallout 4, because you're throwing them in a cryo chamber, that makes sense. But wandering the wasteland, that's probably not the toughest material. Like, I'm a huge military history, probably like 10 years, but I've served in multiple branches. My first branch is the Navy, so like an old school boiler suit, I'm talking like Nomex, fireproof, big, huge, like blue overalls. Like, that's something I could see crawling around the wasteland.
Yeah.
And that makes sense. So, like, I like some of the Fallout 3 aesthetics and design choice that I'm not going to see ported over to the show, but I'm okay with that. I think the vaults look amazing. I think some of the weapons you could definitely tell are there. A lot of people are like, oh, the Fallout, you know, the power armor suit moves differently or the face closes differently. I was like, yeah, but that kind of makes sense. If I'm in an irradiated area, I would want power armor where I could just open the visor and not take off my full hermetically sealed helmet.
Yeah, but there's always going to be, and you know, and I probably can't talk too much because I'm like that with like Star Wars lore, but that's, you know, I could go on for days about that. But when you go into something like that and you're already nitpicking little things like that, the power armor not having the right, you know, the gears missed out by 4 inches, you're just going into it to be disappointed. I think what made Fallout so great, especially like the transitions between 1, 2, 3, New Vegas 4, is that the aesthetics, you know, were so different between each one, but they followed the subject matter. And so, you know, when you look at 3, it was dark. It was just a dark game. It was, everything had this green hue.
It was dark. I forgot what, between all the slavery and stuff,
how dark that game was. Just a gritty game. And then you go to New Vegas and the sun's always out. So it's, you know what I mean? It, the aesthetics were so different, but you know, you knew you were in the same universe, even with those big aesthetic changes. And I think that's what makes Fallout so great, is that they're constantly changing these aesthetics while still staying to the subject matter. And so I'm excited to see what new aesthetic that this show brings to that universe. So I don't think really the aesthetics is something that, because like the games, they all look so different. So I'm excited to see what they do aesthetic-wise, what the guns look like, you know, what if we're going to get new weaponry maybe, while still sticking to the core of the subject matter.
Yeah, like, it's so funny. Like, I have a whole bunch of just Fallout-themed stuff in my house. Like, not even just, like, actual stuff I bought, like props, but just, like, my natural firearm collection because of Fallout New Vegas, like, leans towards, you know, so we see in Fallout. One of the funniest ones is I was sitting there, I went into my my study. Yeah, I have a house, I know, I'm crazy. But I walked into my study.
Old nerds.
I know, right? I'm sure I keep all my books. It's a book. But up at the top, I have like very little
stuff.
I'm proud of my military service, but I have very few like things hanging up. I've never really been about that life. I never liked dress uniforms. I was always just like just about the work. But part of what I always considered overtime payment in order for the military was, if they issue gear without an NSN code, I was like, oh, I guess it's just for me to keep. I guess this is my pro gear. But one of the things I have from one of my...
For legal purposes, the plate carrier in my closet was definitely purchased.
So one of my favorite things I collected, and I can literally, if you get real close and smell the face part, you can still smell the CS in it and tears. But I have a riot helmet. And I was like, oh man, and I looked at it, and I was playing Fallout 3. I was like, son of a bitch. I was like, that's the exact same. I was like, they're Vault-Tec security. You know, use the exact, because the newer one has like that weird blue thing, and they wear like that kind of weird blue armor. And I was like, oh, they look kind of like lame. But the old ones, like, that's just like legit riot armor with a vault suit. I was like, hey, that's kind of cool. It's actually have like an old riot helmet. I was like, huh. I was like, and I just like moved that over to my man cave. I was like, huh, another Fallout prop. I was like, I think this game influenced me a lot more than I think. But I'm excited. The reason why I bring them, I'm excited to see in the show and see which way they're going. If you look at the vault suits, which I think is a good, almost like a temperature check or like an indicator on how they're kind of doing the show. The vault suits, they don't look super skin tight like Fallout 4, you know, but they also don't look like super baggy like Fallout 1 or 2. So it seems like they're kind of going their own route, which I like. The Mr. Handy looks legit.
Like I said, man.
The vaults look great. A lot of the aesthetics are pretty cool. I was going to mention something I thought that they really, really... Oh, at first I was worried the town, just like everybody else, the town really did look just like Megaton before I made my really correct decision and redecorated it.
Yeah, before I turned it into a bowl.
But I mean, the town looks great. I like everything about it. I think Walter Goggins is a great pick. You know, I think he does. I think he particularly does a good job of mixing action with humor. You know, you look at Justified. I mean, he is perfect.
Yeah, I agree. And exactly, it's. I'm glad you made that point. It's exactly what I was going to say. It's, yeah, especially that line in the trailer. Correct me. I'm probably paraphrasing this, but you know, what's one drop of drug in a sea of drugs, or whatever she said when, or he said when they injected him with that stuff.
Yeah,
or she shot him. Yeah, shot him with the
cart. That's a very little drop in a very large bucket of drugs. And everyone's like, he's supposed to say Kim's. I was like, yeah, but he's pre-war.
Yeah, so exactly.
Said drugs, and he's stuck with drugs because that's what they were before.
That's exactly, you know? Yeah, because he's the guy that's, you know, advertising the vault. So this guy's obviously pre, you know, bombs going off October, what, 2077?
Yeah, 27th. And that's, so the other thing people were talking about, like, how come the NCR, speaking of settings, like, how come the NCR look different? How come they're wearing their cliche, like, Brody-looking helmets, you know, with, like, tan gear and M16s or service rifles? Mm-hmm. And the way I look at it is, you'll probably remember this from Fallout New Vegas, if you listen and you really kind of look into the NCR, they've already extended, by the time of New Vegas, they've already kind of extended past what they can handle. They've dried up their aquifers. You know, they're running out. They have more people than they have water and resources. So it's not just that they're making a bid for New Vegas. They desperately needed New Vegas. They needed the water and the power, but more importantly, they needed the water. And that's the interesting part. So when I look at this and I see it looks like, the NCR is kind of falling in hard times. Like, yeah, they overextended. That's what you hear about New Vegas. Like, this actually makes sense. And it seems like...
Yeah, do we know what year this show is taking place?
I believe it's taking place after Fallout 4. I think it's about as comfortable as I'm enough saying, because I don't know too much about the details. I think it's takes place after Fallout 4. So it makes sense that I think in Fallout 3, I don't know about the canonical ending, but the Brotherhood takes out the Enclave, which I think is canon. And they have access to all the stuff they used to have. That's why they have more vertebrates, the Pridwin. And this ship is actually, I think, the sister ship to the Pridwin. I can't remember the exact name. I know it also has to do with the King Arthur lore. It has one of those very unique names that goes with that whole fable. But that's why they have vertebrates, their giant, you know, aircraft carrier, which, if you're a history nerd, we actually did have those way back in the day. We had two of them. Oh, they didn't work out very well.
I got a year here for you. 2296.
It's 2296.
Yeah,
there we go.
They're well after the 2155 event.
Yeah.
So, yeah, they're...
So yeah, I think the Brotherhood, because we all know the canonically the NCR, you know, took out Father Elijah and the Brotherhood of Steel, who were guarding Helios 1.
Yep.
So the NCR kind of beat the Brotherhood in their first battle. So what I think this one is, the Brotherhood was basically able to rally, you know, get some of the other Brotherhood together, some of the other chapters, consolidate, kind of build some more power armor, get ready to attack them more on a unified front, because they're all military, versus the NCR, who just has a strong military branch. I think the NCR was already crumbling. And the coolest thing is, if you look at that one part of the video where she's standing next to the Squire from the Brotherhood of Steel, they're standing in that giant crater where he talks about everyone wants to save the world, there's different ways how. Right before that, when you zoom out, it says Shady Sands Library. So the weird thing about that is some people are like, well, Shady Sands was in the first game, you know, that becomes the headquarters of the NCR, which we know. But it wasn't a real pre-war town. It was just a settlement, and they called it Shady Sands because it was somewhat shady. Sandy, I get that. But that's what I'm saying. I was like, yeah, but, you know, they built this place up since they founded the NCR, so maybe they built a library, but it looks like a bomb went off. It looks like it got the old Megaton treatment, you know, from Timpani Tower. It looks like a bomb went off and took out the capital of the NCR. So now that's what the show looks like to me. I know I'm kind of jibber-jabbering. It looks like it's going to be a really good fight between the NCR and the Brotherhood of Steel. What I like is I feel like it's taking the spirit of New Vegas. I'm very careful saying this, because this could blow up my back. People could be like, you lie, you were wrong. But it looks like it's taking the spirit of New Vegas, where there are no good guys, there are no good factions. You just have, you know, different people, and they all have a certain way. You know, like, the Brotherhood of Steel aren't portrayed as the good guys. They're just a military, you know, branch. Okay, cool. The NCR aren't the good guys. They're just an old world bureaucracy. Yep. The Vault Dwellers aren't the good guys. They're just naive as hell. So it's like, what's going to happen? You have three kind of neutral factions, and I'm really excited to see that.
Yeah, and the Ad Victoriam in me is going to disagree. The Steel Brotherhood, you know, Brotherhood of Steel is the way. But, no, yeah, I agree. You have your zealots. You have NCR, of course, trying to go the old world, or version of the old world government. But I'm excited to see what they do with it all, especially what kind of narrative we're going to be following in the TV series, as far as, you know, how they portray each of the factions, if they stay true to, you know, the lore itself. But, you know, I've got the emblem on me. I'm really excited to see what they do with the Brotherhood of Steel.
Yeah, it looks good. Brotherhood of Steel has always kind of made sense to me, because you kind of have to, like, earn your keep, and it just makes all their characters just well-written.
Well, yeah, and the Brotherhood of Steel has so much lore into the beginnings of, you know, especially with the, you know, without rambling forever like I can about it, but, you know, it goes back to the FEV, you know, what created the super mutants. There's just so much rich lore falling around this Brotherhood of Steel. It's just always been my favorite faction in all the games.
Yeah, even just that one part of the lore, the very beginning, for those of you who don't know, and please do correct me if I'm wrong, but the whole thing back at Mariposa Military Base, when they found out the experiments were on not just civilians, but their own soldiers.
The POWs.
Max was like, you know what? If this is called treasonous, then I'll proudly be a traitor. Then he literally sent that whole letter. You know, then it turns out that the war happened and no one cares anyways. And so now they're so strict to their code. It's almost like by being traitors, they were true to themselves, and it's their ultimate, like, true code. It's just really well written. That only kind of like that old school game lore really kind of is this day. It really just kind of writes itself and just deepens further and further with each game.
No, and that's what makes Fallout so great, because there is so much phenomenal lore. But yeah, you're right, Maxim. It was what they were using in FEV, the evolutionary virus, on POWs, prisoners of war. And it was like super top secret. And the original commander, once it was all found out, commits suicide. And, you know, Max takes over and then ends up deserting after the bombs go off and creating the first Brotherhood of Steel chapter. I mean, it's such a well-written, you know, backstory and that stuff. And it draws me in every time.
Yeah, it really is good. And so the other thing I liked in Fallout 3, they seemed almost like too much of good guys. There's nothing wrong with that, you know, because it was a dark game. So I think that's the other reason they look like new, you know, good guys. And after what happened in the pit and stuff like that, it kind of made sense why that crusade went the way it did. And that's why I liked Fallout 4, where they're a little bit darker, because he's like, I grew up watching that whole thing happen. I saw that you can't always be a good guy, you know, talking about Arthur Max in, you know, Fallout 4. And it looks like he kind of brought in the Renegades of the Brotherhood of Steel. You know, he brought in the Defenders and all the other guys. He basically united the Brotherhood of Steel on the East Coast and made them strong again. So I think it's all coming full circle. I like when the Brotherhood of Steel aren't like 100% perfect good guys. Like, no, we're here to take the tech, because you like ignorant wastelanders cannot be trusted with tech. Like, look what happened last time, you know, on October 27th. Like, this is why we're going to protect you from yourselves. Like, if you guys want to fight and raid each other's village with, you know, I don't know, like 9mm pistols and poison spears, you knock yourselves out, but you're not getting a tri-beam laser rifle.
Yeah, poison spears looking at you, Max, and when he killed
with
his arrow of the Viper.
I dropped that in there. I was like, oh, yeah, that was good. Let me drop a crumb. Yeah. Mm.
But, yum, 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 yum.
the show looks good. I've seen, speaking of weapons, you know, being a nerdy guy I am, a lot of the weapons look pretty good. I think the chick who takes the fork in the eye, I think she's using like a Sterling SMG, which we haven't seen yet, but that would totally fit. That's cool. I think the main character keeps using like this little trank pistol until she finally finds her ever classic 10mm, which, by the way, I had my first range day with my new 10mm. I've never shot a 10mm before.
It's like 40.
Oh, yeah. 40 wishes. But yeah, so yeah, it's what a lot of people don't know is the 40, before I get into the whole huge nerd thing and talk about the Miami-Dade shootout and the FBI and the 10mm and the 40 S&W, before I get into that whole rabbit hole, you know, a 10mm, if you want to think about it, a 10mm is a more powerful form of a 40 Smith & Wesson.
Yep.
So I actually went to the range and I was shooting and I was like, I 100% understand why this is like the chosen gun for like a wasteland, like be it a Rad Scorpion or some dude hopped up on jet. Like this is a cordless hole punch for sure. It's got a hefty kick, and that's why I see why people call it a heavy pistol. And the one I actually have is very heavy. I was like, oh, this, so it mitigates the recoil. It's like, this is actually a very, if you're walking around with just one pistol, this makes a lot of sense. Like, I kind of get why the 10 mil is so iconic. So that's actually really neat. I'm glad I saw that in the trailer. You see the assault rifle, of course, which makes sense that they wanted an assault rifle. And I dug into, I forget which documentary it was, they're talking about Fallout 4 on why they made the assault rifle look the way it does. And it makes sense now too, not just to kind of copyright it so that it can't be, you know, taken elsewhere, and that way they don't have to pay the manufacturer, you know, whoever it is, you know, whatever gun they're using, you know, they don't have to use the name, but also make it look better with power armor. So if you're walking around with like a regular G3 and power armor, it looks kind of weird, you know, but in the new, bigger, bulkier power armor they have from Fallout 4 and in the shows, the assault rifle almost functions more like a automatic rifle or a light machine gun. It's kind of given more, I said like Lewis gun vibes, kind of like that walking fire from the iconic original days of fully automatic weapons, without going down that rabbit hole either.
Yeah, but, nice chuck.
Yeah, it's really turning a squad automatic weapon into a guy with power armor. Like, that actually makes sense. He would be your base of fire like that one.
Oh, yeah, or sense. Accuracy by volume, as
exactly.
I like to say.
Exactly, yeah.
You fill the air with enough bullets, it's harder to miss.
The old find, fix, flank, and finish. And that's the cool thing, is seeing the Brotherhood of Steel use those real tactics that they've now refined, yeah. While the NCR is almost kind of just using whatever they can. So yeah, that's
two four is punching the air right now. Don't want to fill this full of military jargon, but.
So with that being said, we both like the show. There's plenty of good scenes. I like how we address one thing we address, where I like a lot of people are zoning on the two things about how he said it's not, I can't make it just what the fans want. I get why he said that. I'm glad we addressed that. And the other thing is, you know, the Walter Goggins classic lines. First of all, it's a great line, great delivery. Secondly, you're like, why do you say drugs when it's Kim's? He's a pretty
It's funny, I didn't make that connection until you said that. And it didn't bother me when I heard it. I was just excited. They were throwing that humor out there, letting us know we're going the goofy, we're gonna have some humor. That's a fantastic point, and I didn't put that together until you said that.
So as I was already gushing about the 10 mil, which a little I still can't remember. So for those who don't know where I live in Tiki Land. It's out in the middle of nowhere, and when I went to my place for my FFL, the transfer to pick it up, and when I walk in, and this is a small gun store owned by a veteran, of course, in the middle of a small town out in the middle of nowhere. So I'm just giving you, so you can get the proportion of population to like Fallout fan, right? So as I walk in, the first guy who sees me is like, oh dude, because I purchased it, it came in, I got really busy at work, so it was like a week and a half, I can go pick it up. So by the time I walked in, like, oh dude, we wait for you to come in, we have a bet going, is it for the memes or for like, you know, kind of real life? Like, no. So in there we started talking about Fallout the whole time. I was sitting there, I was like, what a great fan base, you know. And this is just in the middle of a small town out in the middle of nowhere, and people are already talking about this. And some dude showed me his custom built, you know, AR. I was like, oh, that's so, with the wood furniture, I was like, oh, that's so iconic and so cool.
Yeah,
so,
and that's great when we latch on to stuff like that. It's like the, you know, the Nuka Cola bottle I have on my forearm. I get one of two reactions. I get people going, oh, do you have a Coca-Cola bottle? And I'm like, I'm not even gonna go through the explanation. I'm like, yep, it's a Coca-Cola bottle. And then I have the other people that look at it, their eyes get real wide, and they go, no way. And then they'll, like, look at it, and they're like, is that a Nuka Cola? And I'm like, yeah, dude. And it's just that immediate, like, me and the stranger are friends now. Like, they understand.
So one of my favorite things, something I've always done, it's cheesy, and people made fun of me. One of my last roles in the military before I got out is I was an instructor. You know, I was one of the few people in my career with deployment experience still in. And so, like, hey, can you teach us how to do all those things? Like, yes. So I was an instructor, and I always talk a lot. So on my training desk, where I kept everyone's records and where I did a lot of my PowerPoint Ranger, you know, that kind of teaching stuff,
I kept
the speech bobblehead. And, you know, not a lot of people picked up on it and stuff like that, but I thought it was funny. And then later on, when I left the military, I wanted to do something completely different from what I did. I wanted to start all over, you know, and learn a whole new trade. And I didn't know shit about cars at all. So I was like, let me learn about cars, because I feel like as a guy, I should know about cars. So I literally just, and this is right when the plague hit, like 2020, right? So I called up, and AAA is like, do you have a clean driving record? Yes. Have you committed any felonies? It's like, not that I know of, and not in this country. They're like, that's good enough, we'll take you. So, you know, I'm rolling around with AAA during the plague, and it's the coolest job, because I had no boss for a while. I was like, yeah, dude. Oh, yeah. And they're like, you don't even have a quota for sales. Like, other guys will handle the sales. You just do emergency road work. Like, I just drive around to help people, and you pay me. Like, yeah, that's your job. Here's your van. Here's all your tools. It's like, it wasn't a lot of money, but it was an absolute blast and the perfect freedom job if you're transitioning out of the military. So the first thing I bought for my van after I got all my tools, of course, was a repair bobblehead, which I kept right on the dash. And the amount of comments I got from that alone, dude, I think that probably drove up my tip sales better than anything else. You're like, oh, that's awesome. Like, one dude, while I was working on his car in a convenience store, he's like, hey, man, I don't have any cash, but I got this. He ran in and bought me, like, a Mexican, you know, those big old, like, medio litro, you know, like 500 milliliters, like, Mexican Coke. So I was like, dude, and it was, like, ice cold.
It was real sugar, too.
Yeah, I was like, dude, best tip in the world. So, like I said, another glimpse into what kind of, like, Fallout nerd I am. I don't have the job anymore. I moved on, obviously. I still love that job. It was a cool job. I work elsewhere now. But it's just a fun little tidbit story when you told me about your tattoo. But we were talking about 10 mils and the service rifle. So with that being said, I kind of want to lead you into what was your favorite of all the games, your favorite Fallout item or weapon? Hands down, you had to choose.
And people are going to kind of halfway pre-planned here, but we're going to say it together on three. One, two, three.
The bottle cap mine. Dude, hands down. Brother. So, we didn't want to, like, we're trying to do this as spontaneous as possible. We're just kind of, like, joking around about some of this stuff. And I literally just kind of asked, like, make sure you're kind of thinking. I was like, hey, this is just mine. And then he's like, oh, dude, that's mine too. It has always been my favorite. I don't know if it's the sound effects. I don't know if it's just, you know, years spent, you know, walking around learning not to kick rocks. And
yeah, that's
for 1+1.
It may be a tinge of the PTSD on both ends here.
I think the GWAT veteran appreciates the creativity behind the ID that is the bottle cap mine.
A pressure plate 105. You can't help but just sit there and go, nice, dude. Like, pretty ingenious.
I think there's better feeling than, like, walking around after you kill whatever you use the bottle cap mine. Like, I literally always carry one in my inventory just in case I come across something that I wasn't planning on, even in survival mode. I want to say the first time I used one was Fallout 3 when I was in Grey Ditch. You know, I was like, oh, what's this kid bitching about? Let me go find what took your dad. I wonder if it's a bell. I was like, holy shit, they're fire ants. Oh, God, they can breathe fire. And I think I was, like, fighting a queen in the tunnels. And I was like, you know, she was really kicking my ass. I was running out of stim packs. Like, I have mines. I was like, my grenades were good, but they weren't that good. I was like, let me drop this bottle cap mine and see what happens. Luckily, I was far enough away, but dude, the explosion and then the fact that I could walk over and pick up some bottle caps was like, this is now my favorite weapon of all time. Like, this is awesome.
I had them stockpiled, and that's hit a rough. I had them stockpiled. I hadn't been using them the whole game, and encountered Deathclaw, and I'm running out of ammunition fast. Dumping mags. And I'm like, all I got are these bottle cap mine. And I just start spamming, dropping them as I'm running. And all I hear behind me is that turn around, it's dead, and bottle caps everywhere. And that's when it was the best, the absolute best.
There's a lot of runners up. Like I said, again, I allude to it, I don't talk directly about it, but I did a lot of military. One of my specialties was firearms. So as a civilian, I really appreciate resiliency or anything else. So my personal collection has a lot of revolvers, lever action, stuff like that.
Oh, yeah.
I'm always a big fan of, like, pump action. Reliability is always big with me. And but I've always loved Fallout. There's a lot of good weapons, but of all the stuff out there, you know, yeah, the bottle cap mine was always a top. And I'll never forget, I played Fallout Wasteland Warfare and the RPG version of it. I actually put my wife, this is before I ever got her to play D&D, I put her through, you know, I was like, hey, can you help me test this whole thing I'm writing out? And the cool thing is you can order these bottle caps from Adiphius. You know, it comes with one card. I was like, what's the card? And it's a bottle cap mine. I was like, oh, God, that's so cool. But so I put it into all this stuff. Like, it's just for whatever reason, it's my favorite. I know I still need this antidote. So one of the many things is I'm kind of building out my man cave and kind of setting out. I'm a huge theme whore. So me and wife, I have the day off. We're going to watch when the Fallout show comes out. And so I'm trying to, like, get the stuff ready to set up the decor for our house. You know, so it's all, like, kind of Fallout themed while I watch it. You know, that's just my style. I'm a nerd like that. I know it makes me happy at this ripe old age, you know, so I do it. And as I got a full, because all the little lunchboxes I could find were generally the small ones. So I finally found an actual lunchbox that's, like, Fallout themed. It's, like, a full-size metal lunchbox. And that's when I really looked at it and realized, you know, I know we were joking about it offline, but, you know, here online, I won't say the extra stuff that goes into it. But I was joking about how much, you know, primary and secondary and, like, ordnance and payload you could put in this thing. I was like, this is a massive fucking lunchbox. Like, no wonder it does so much damage. Like, I was actually looking at what you could fit in there. I was like,
little tin shrapnel too.
Seriously, I was like, there. I was like, no wonder this. I was always wondering why it did so much damage. But I was like, I now fully understand. I never appreciate how big this lunchbox is. Like, you could pack a whole lot of regret.
Yeah, a lot of frag in there, dude. Put some nails. Yeah. Get some.
Oh yeah.
A lot of democracy you can fit.
You got to remember, a lot of the, especially if you're looking at like the DC wasteland, a lot of the ground is already begging for shrapnel. I mean, you put halfway in a fallen down house, you have all sorts of stuff that's going to come flying at you, not just what's in the model cap.
Well,
with
I think
that being said, so we'll rob the audience, what was your, you got to pick a second favorite.
So that's what I was getting ready to say, man.
Right to it.
This is actually, and like you said earlier, Fallout 4, it was great for what it was. It did, however, give me the power glove. It was just that, like, mechanic brass knuckle with the rebar sticking out of the knuckles. That may not be the actual name for it. But it was, like, this power glove you could get early on. And it was just, like, a hydraulic brass knuckle with rebar sticking out of the ends of it. And I did a full-strength character in Fallout 4 and just ran around, like, falcon punching everything I saw with that glove, and it made me so happy just to beat a super mutant up with my fists.
And that's very worthy. Yeah, it shows how much I played that game. Like, I remember I was playing it, and my dad was playing it. It's like, hey, where do I find this? Like, you go, you know, go this way for about 10 minutes and turn left here, and you'll find I played that game way too much. But yeah, the power fist, especially the one you got from killing Swan.
Yeah,
you get that furious with the rebar sticking out of it. But you know, Veronica used a power fist in New Vegas, and I think a lot of I call him Caesar, not Kaisar. You know, harass me.
Caesar's Legion.
Please. Yeah. So I call him Caesar. But a lot of his Praetorian guards use power fists too.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, it's always a good viable weapon. It doesn't run out of ammo. You know, it's pretty easy to fix. You know, that always made sense for me. I never minded that. Man, there's just so many good weapons. At least for Fallout 4, one of my favorite go to is always rush to pick it up. It wasn't the best weapon, but it was just so damn useful. It was Big Jim's pipe wrench. Probably southwest of the starting point. You kind of go down till you find like somebody's little museum. I forget who it is, like one of those nature writers.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's like Walton's or something like that. But when you find it, it's down in the basement. It's pretty good. That was always kind of a go-to. Another fun story about how much of a Fallout nerd I am. Probably the only cosplay I've ever done. For a while, I played MagFed paintball. It was a blast. I used a lot of MagFed paintball markers in my training when I couldn't get my hands on some munitions because they're expensive, you know? And so I would just use my own supply of paintball markers and magazine ones to make it more realistic. I could get more training. So on the civilian side, I was like, oh, sure, let me go play with some people in the woods. That'll be fun. So we went to a Christmas event, and it was being held. It was two different states had these MagFed teams that were going against each other for like a fun little meet, and all the money was going to charity. So it's like, yeah, I'll drive up there and, you know, pay all this money. That's fine. And it turns out on one of the quote unquote maps, or one of the courses they had ready for this MagFed paintball, was a one for one creation of Nuketown from Call of Duty, like any of the Call of Duties. So they had that Nuketown, that classic 1950s thing built, and they told us that. So I went up there fully dressed like a vault dweller. Now, with this being said, again, I'm not a cosplay guy, so all I did was go out to Spirit Halloween and buy that vault suit. If you've never seen that costume or seen how thin it is, first off, the only size, like, one size fits all, but I'm still kind of a tall guy. And even then, I was in better shape, but I was still kind of big. So I clearly look like a vault tin dweller, you know, just like Twig from the Fallout show. Have you ever seen that? The Nuka Brick. Yeah, I was kind of a well-fed vault dweller. So I was running out there. My pistol already kind of looked like a 10 mil. So I had a 10 mil and a riot shield. And there's guys out there with these special paintballs called First Strikes. What it is, it's like a half spherical paintball with a plastic shell that attaches to it that spins in a rifle barrel. So those things come out hot and fast. And that's how I found out quickly how thin that costume was.
Oh yeah, I bet you felt that real quick.
Oh, right in the ribs. Like, I immediately regret my decision. But the reason why I bring this up is because of MagFed, you can have little foam weapons where if you close with your person and you tag them with it, they're out. It's like barrel tagging, but use like safe foam weaponry kind of. So it's kind of like a mix between LARP and paintball, I guess. I thought it was cool for a little while. So mine was just this giant wrench. It made me think of Fallout. I was like, I would love just to walk around with like a wrench. But if I really had to pick a secondary...
you get your Bioshock on.
Right? Yeah. Yeah, so many different things. If I really had to pick a secondary weapon, it'd either be the tin mill or the medicine stick. I love lever actions, and I'm
okay,
all
yeah.
45-70. I think the Ranger Sequoia, like, that's that is a gun in real life. There is a 45-70 government revolver, BFR. It's expensive, and it looks massive and huge. But a 45-70 out of a lever action just seems like a great thing to have in the wasteland for like.
Oh yeah, it slaps levels. Different.
Oh yeah, that's if you go to like the Winchester website and you look up their 45-70, they actually have like a dinosaur listed with all the other game that used it on from like, and it's the same rifle, or he used a guide version, so it has a smaller magazine too.
Yeah,
he used in Jurassic World, which was very appropriate weapon for, you know,
phenomenal platform. Well, shotguns for me, I just bought an AR-12, so I can't really sling a 12 gauge out of a 10 round banana mag right now. And, the 45 second fantastic. Yeah, there are so many good guns in those games. So, and there's even down to just like the Caesar's Legion used the javelins, the throwing javelins, pretty sick.
Yeah, I plan on doing a whole episode on the Caesar's Legion, like really kind of getting into the nitty gritty. All the cut content, why they are the way they are, and stuff like that.
The capture, the slaves, yeah, it's.
But it sounds so bad. Again, obviously, I don't endorse slavery or anything like that. But Arizona was safe, you know, at least for the traders. You can talk to a lot of the traders; they'll tell you that. Like, say what you will, man, but when I walk on those roads, there's no raiders to harass me. So.
And it only took a 50 in medicine to getting good with them.
Yeah, right.
I understand.
That healing powder really comes in handy. You know, don't get it in your eyes.
Understand complex neurosurgery, and the Caesar's Legion will accept you.
I just gave a Mark in Gannon.
There you go. It's funny, once you put those so many times, you know, I started stacking medicine at the beginning, so I'm like, I know which way I'm going at the end of this.
Yeah, same thing while I was watching me do a playthrough. She's like, why are you picking the repair skill so early on? I was like, you see that broken 9mm submachine gun over there? I was like, not today. Oh, you know what? There you go. If I had to pick a favorite weapon, I think of all the genres, you know, if not the weathered 10mm, it would be the Vicky Advanced submachine gun. I love grease guns. I have a whole story that I know I told you I won't say here. I have a whole story about my misadventures involving, you know, an M3A1 grease gun. You know, like, there's this whole huge story behind it. I've always been to shoot one. Hopefully, I will when I go to Vegas. That's what I have planned.
Oh yeah, maybe stay in that.
Yeah, it's one of my dream things. There's a whole huge hilarious story behind it. But it's so funny that our favorite weapon ended up being the same, the bottle cap mine. Yeah, I don't hear it mentioned very often. Other than you, I don't hear it mentioned. Like, I cruise the forums like any good nerd, and I just don't see it mentioned when people talk about the show or about Fallout in general. So that's it was a huge surprise.
I love me some improvised explosives. I can't help it.
And with that, I think that's Bafty knocking on my front door. Let me go hide my dogs. So moving right along to the next question, nothing to see here, is this is the controversial one, right? So take time. You can pick, you know, one or two, because I have one or two myself. If you could see, if you got put on the creative board, I guess, for Fallout 5, they keep trying to say the show is Fallout 5. I get why, but I'm talking about Fallout 5, the game. You know, if you could pick a location for Fallout 5, where would it be and why?
Is zero thought behind this. Chicago, man. I need the tactics done right. I want to know what happened with the Midwest chapter. I need to know, you know, make it lore. I really want to see, because I think they've alluded to Chicago a little bit through the games. I need me that Midwest Brotherhood of Steel. I need to know what's going on over there.
Tactics done right, you bastard.
Yeah.
I went back and played it. I don't do streaming yet on my YouTube channel. I said if I got to a certain view count, I would actually start doing some live streaming. But I'm testing it, and I live stream to a Discord group that I'm really active in. And I play Fallout Tactics. Some of the younger people are like, oh, what game is that? I was like, it's Fallout Tactics, man.
Oh, there's nothing wrong with tactics. It's more to make it, you know, canon. I need canon.
But the cool part is, I don't know, I'm actually going to start hosting a Fallout 2D20 campaign here coming up pretty soon, including, you know, Kreech here. But, the character creation to that game is ripped almost one for one straight from Tactics.
Fantastic.
The same way you create a character in Tactics, it's very similar to the way you create it for Fallout 2D20, which I absolutely love.
Wife and I have been going through the rule set. Super, super cool.
Yeah, you go back to tagging skills and stuff like that. It's groovy. So with that being said, so any other place other than Chicago, or is that your top one? You want to see what happened to the Midwest?
I need Midwest. I mean, there's so many great other ones, of course. Getting the Northern California, up there, because I know we took place in South, so San Francisco maybe, which I think there's already been a little bit of talk about that. But yeah, Chicago is the big one for me, because Chicago was hit so hard when the war started. It's been pretty much wiped off the face. It was one of the main targets, when the bombs dropped. So not a lot left. So I'm curious to see what those factions were doing at that. Because correct me if I'm wrong, but the Midwest faction took a really heavy hit fighting the Enclave out there, and pretty much having to rebuild. So I think getting to see that whole narrative would be really interesting.
Spoiler alert, I think technically you would consider it part of the overall Enclave, but what they fought was how would you say this? So it was kind of like a computer that was built in like the Davis-Monthan complex, way out in Colorado. So like,
yeah, wasn't it the calculator?
So it was the calculator, yeah. And he basically ran NORAD, so they invented a computer to run that whole thing. I think Pam alludes to that when you talk to her in Fallout 4.
Yeah.
So basically started creating an army of robots, and that's who you end up having to fight. And the cool thing is, you're right, they take such a beating that they actually have to start recruiting from us filthy savages, and that's where the game kind of starts, is you have to earn your spot, into the Brotherhood of Steel, which is actually kind of
cool. They were even taking non-human, right? Were they taking some ghouls as well?
So they didn't take ghouls until that was the one that took place down in Texas.
You're right.
I think they, as for like cannon fodder, I think they would. It's good to have morals when you have a flying battle barge with vertebrates and all sorts of stuff. But when you really start to run low, you're like, yeah, sure, why not? Like, everyone's got a little bit of radiation in them. Just run that way really fast.
Much like Caesar.
Two guys, one rifle. Exactly, yeah. It's like the Brotherhood of Steel auxiliary would be, savages and mutants and all sorts of stuff. Like, whatever, can just soak up the bullets. And then... the scribes and the knights would come in to kind of clean up. That would kind of make sense.
Looking at you, Stalingrad.
Yeah, right. It's exactly what I was going with. Like, one person gets the energy cell, one person gets the last
pistol. You get potatoes.
So, for me, without ruining too much about my overall Fallout 2D20 campaign and my whole, head lore, because it goes so far. Like,
yeah, give me some inside DM.
It's roughly going to take place. So the first game we're going to play takes place up in the Commonwealth before Fallout 4, just because it's a set module. But the rest of it is going to take place in what I like to call, me myself, the Glowing Gulf. So the place I'm absolutely obsessed with and I love is you take about East Texas all the way over to all of Florida and the whole Gulf Commonwealth in between. So it's basically just the long I-10 and all the hell that goes with it.
I like that a lot.
So the reason why I like to focus on that is you go back to the Enclave's goal of trying to get into space. Well, you have obviously the NASA Kennedy Space, NASA Center in Houston, and then you also have the one down in Cape Canaveral, Florida. There's the two main space. Well, now you have Vandenberg and stuff like that over in California, but obviously that's a no-go. Enclave already did their operations in California. Spoiler alert. It didn't work out very well, so now they're focused on the two other large space bases. And so, the Enclave will be remnants. And also, I want to see, if you remember, oh my god, it's going to be so embarrassing, I cannot remember the vault number. I think it's 26 from New Vegas, the one with the overgrown plants.
Oh man, you're going to kill me here.
This shows that we're nerds, we're not super nerds. So please, if you do know, go in the comment section, I'd love to see some interactions. Please feel free to correct me. So we'll run with it being Vault 26 from here. We'll see if I get corrected. When you go in there, it's all like the mutant plant growth where you try and like grow food, and there's all those like weird plant monsters. I would want to see that, but that for all of Florida. And also,
that would be super interesting.
If you look up in one of my favorite DLCs, it's another hot take. Oh, get ready for this one. Nuka World was my favorite DLC. I think of of any Fallout game, Nuka World is my favorite. And you kind of take that and apply, Nuka Land down in Florida, kind of mimicking the whole Disneyland, Disney World kind of vibe. And if you think about the Gator Claws, imagine Gator Claws actually being down in Florida. There's no Death Claws or Gator Claws. And the other thing is, there's no rad storms, but there's radicanes. So imagine hurricanes coming in, but they're full of radiation.
That, so, man, we like this.
And it's basically like I call it the green hell.
I'm sorry, the Everglades hell. In the Fallout universe would be terrifying.
That's exactly what I'm going for. It's a different kind of vibe. You have DC, which was like urban. You have, you know, New Vegas, which is like kind of out in the desert. And then you imagine having an overgrown forest just full of all sorts of irradiated stuff.
Fallout Vietnam. That's
basically, yeah. The trees are talking ghoul, you know?
The trees are talking ghoul.
So with that being said, here's my other setting I would love, because I'm cheating on taking two, is mostly for the vibes, the music, and the isolation. I would love to see Fallout Hawaii, even if it's just on the island of like Oahu. I think that would be super cool because it's self-contained.
Radiated firestorms.
Yeah, you know, yeah, volcanoes and stuff. Like, oh my god, could you imagine all the different, like, lot of it would be taking place. It would be like underwater, on water. There'd be so much stuff going on out there.
Magma bugs.
So isolated. Yeah.
I like that. I think even exploring like outside of the States, what's going on over in Europe? You know, let's delve into all of it over there.
So I know there's some, I don't want to say they're Russian, some are Russian, I think some are some other countries. I don't want to disrespect anybody by not knowing the name of their country. But there's a couple fan-made games that take place like all over like Mexico and the Sonora Desert, and those actually look pretty damn good. That's also pretty damn interesting. And I know Raul talks a lot about, you know, what happened to Mexico during the Fallout. That's pretty good.
Yeah, man, even doing this to all this talk, and I'm so hoping this show hits the mark.
And that's what I'm going for. Like I said, if you guys can't tell, this podcast, it's super laid back. Like, clearly, I don't even know all the vaults. You know, I failed my nerd test. I actually did fail the goats. You know, who knew? But
I did find an answer. I'm not going to say it. I'm going to let you.
Oh, say it. Say it. Correct me.
22, man.
Oh, son of a bitch. Because I thought it was 22, but I know 21 was the gambling one, because that makes sense, because of 21 blackjack. But I was like, maybe it's 26, because 22 makes me think of 33, like the show. Oh, son of a bitch. Well, as you can tell, this is definitely off the cuff and kind of just more of a laid-back, fun version. We don't care if people fact-check us. And the whole thing is just to keep the Fallout vibes going. It doesn't matter why you play. It doesn't matter how you play. You could go for optimal power build. You could save scum. You could play Fallout whichever way you want. This is just for all the people who just enjoy the aesthetic. Even people who don't like the game, like my wife, we don't really play the Fallout game, but she loves like the design and just the feel of it. Probably, you know, just being so close to me who's listens to it all the time. So that's what this podcast is for. Anybody who just enjoys anything about the Fallout aesthetic. Sometimes we get our stuff right that we talk about. Sometimes we get it way wrong. Clearly, like Vault 22 and Vault 26. But it's just supposed to be good vibes, man. In the wasteland, you know, sometimes that's all you need is just the good vibes.
Absolutely, man. And this has been so much fun. This has been a really good time. And I really appreciate you having me here.
Anytime. If you guys are liking this, like I said, this will come out at least once a month, maybe twice a month. Kreech is definitely going to be a reoccurring character, just because, like I said, we're buddies in real life. I kind of beat the hell out of him in our ongoing D&D campaign.
He owes me with this.
Seriously?
After that,
can we level up? No, but you can be on a podcast. Yeah. Does that work?
I level up? Nope, but this boat's a mimic.
Oh, okay. Rowboat mimics. First of all... Secondly, it's definitely a thing, and you should always use it. It's so funny not to get off on a tangent. You guys should see the way these guys don't trust any kind of boat they see. If they haven't like kept one person watching the entire time, it's a mimic.
Without beating the dead horse here, this man in our last session, we spent almost 30 minutes when a boat showed up. There was nothing wrong with the boat. It was just a boat. But we spent 30 minutes deliberating if this thing had teeth or not.
So to tie back in, my whole DM style comes from 100% Fallout, especially New Vegas, where, you know, the whole world is your sandbox, but it's quicksand. Your decisions matter, and there's only so much time. So there's no bad decisions, but everything you do, put something out in the world's going to react to you. I literally stole that directly from New Vegas, and it's always kind of my design philosophy when I'm DMing. I'm like, you know, what would Benny do besides shoot someone in the head and wear a checkered jacket? You know, I'm like, how would this fit in like a New Vegas style approach to, I guess, not really game development, just like overall game enjoyment.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's fun to be on the edge of your seat sometimes. And I think the Fallout has always done a really good job of conveying that feeling.
All right, so that being said, we'll kind of pull an ending to this ad-libbed kind of podcast between Kreech and myself. Stay tuned for additional episodes. Like I said, they come out once a month to us, twice a month. Never know who's going to show up. I'm a tiny channel, but every now and then, sometimes if I'm lucky, I'm funny. And sometimes I'll roll high enough on my speech check that it'll pull somebody who's much more famous than I or cooler than I to come on this channel and talk about it. Also, you know, keep your eyes on the horizon for the show coming out April 12th. And hopefully before that show drops, there should be something really cool coming from this channel. I've kind of kept my lid on it. If you've been curious where I disappeared to for the last couple months, I've been working on a certain project for about 3 months. I won't say any more about it. You know, I'm kind of keeping it all hush-hush, as it were. But it's taken a lot of my time and resources, so I'm kind of excited to put it out. And it should drop, hopefully, just before the show, kind of help you get in that Fallout vibe. Anything else to add, Kreech?
Nah, man. Thanks again for having me on here. I really look forward to, you know, you'll have me again. And having me on your first episode is really big stuff, dude. And it means a lot to me. And I appreciate all the smooth skins that are coming in and listening. And this has been so much fun.
Yeah, so if you're only catching at the tail end, if you don't want to listen to the full thing, you just cut one of those people who cuts the end of the book, I'll tell you the bottom line, but not up front, but at the end, is ultimately Tunnel Snake's rule, and I think that's really the most important thing to kind of take away from any Fallout game or any Fallout podcast there is. It's just the Tunnel Snakes, man. That's
honestly the best point we've made this entire time.
100%. Okay, so let me ask you this. As we go out, your parting shot, you can't defend it, you can't say why, you just got to pick one. The Kings, Tunnel Snakes, or Atom Cats?
Tunnel Snakes, man. Why would you even ask that?
Tunnel Snakes rule. Thank y'all for joining me on this Fallout Friday. I hope you enjoyed the podcast. And remember, stay safe, stay hydrated, don't forget to relax today, because you're on Tiki Time.
Sunshine, honest I do. That's why you see me smiling at you. You're the flower of old Mother Earth. We've got to lift our hands to you. I love your mountains, trees, and your ocean breeze. Honolulu, I'm wild about you.